PTBO Canada Live is shot in front of a live audience every single Sunday at 3 p.m. at Riley's in downtown Peterborough on George Street. The great thing about Riley's is that my baby went there after having a pretty tough day and tried to sit down at the bar and have two fingers of scotch. Well, Riley's understands that you can't serve to minors, so my baby was turned away. But another great thing about Riley's is every time when you come down to watch the podcast live every Sunday at 3 p.m., they've got cheap beers on. If there's a football game going, then they're going to have cheap wings as well as cheap nachos. It's a great ambiance with a great, great staff and a bunch of great people and a great owner named Jim. He told the Sebastian Bach story in episode 2. You should check that out as well. But now, let's start the podcast.
You make fun of me for starting it that way every day.
I love it, actually. But it's
all right. Well, welcome to PTBO Canada Live with Mike Judson. I'm your host, Mike Judson. And yeah, I say that my name way too much. That's it. It's over.
It's all about you, Mike.
It is.
I thought this show was about PTBO Canada, the story, sharing stories, but it seems to be like
it's about me name with checking. Secondary kind of, you know, follow through creepy uncle PTBO Canada coming in there and helping. I'm just kidding. Anyways, welcome to the third installment of our podcast. And we've actually got a pretty interesting podcast on the way today. We've got a local person who I find to be quite funny. And
me?
No, not you. Okay. You're just Neil Morton. Anyways, her name is Ann Shebib, and a lot of people may not know Anne, but I'm going to predict that people are in fact going to know Anne, and I'm going to push Anne until people know Anne. Right?
Yeah. So she's going to be on our awesome list next year.
Oh, she
or
will.
Our it list.
She will be. And also, we've got former NHLer, former European leaguer, former pedal for Hoper, former pink in the rinker, still an insurance guy. I think it's John Druce is going to be joining us on the show a little bit later on as well.
Hence the t-shirt.
So this is like an old school Washington Capitals shirt, but is that like an actual, like from like the 80s? Cause it looks like
I'm going to go with that. Yeah. It's an authentic jersey from the 80s. Yeah.
It looks like it's got John Druce's sweat stain still ingrained in it.
I can smell it on him. Yeah. It's the stench of Druce. Playoff goals.
I want to smell Druce's playoff goals. Maybe I will a little bit later
and
on.
And it actually says Druce on the back.
It does say Druce on the back.
So hopefully the camera will show that. But
no, it's not gonna.
We get a couple more cameras.
So how's your week been? I feel like I haven't talked to you except for email, like little email blurbs back and forth this week. How you been?
Great, man. It's party season. So I was back up in my old hood in Toronto on Friday night.
Where's the old hood?
The old hood is Leaside.
Leaside.
Yeah, it's not exactly a hood, but I was back with my old basketball friends and the LBA, Leaside Basketball Association. So they invited me to their Christmas basketball banquet, and I went there and they roasted me. So
there are a lot of soccer moms in Leaside, eh?
There are, yeah. It's very much known as that culture, and they're wonderful people, very attentive to their kids, and so we went back there.
Look at this guy. It's wonderful people, very attentive to their children.
Yes.
Seriously, would never hurt a fly.
Yeah.
I absolutely love Leaside, the best ever.
Exactly, and so that was Friday night, and then last night was another party at Elmhurst Lodge, so what? I went from like downtown Toronto to rural area.
Elmer's, that place is like renowned around here for their Christmas parties. It's a good spot, no?
It's beautiful. The amenities are great. The food was spectacular. Turkey, roast beef.
Do they do their own food there?
I believe so, yeah. It tasted like it was made right there. It was real comfort food. So, I overate last night, and now I'm here with you. I'm here. And made it.
You love wrapping up your weekends with me.
I do. And what about you? I heard you went back to Toronto as well.
I did. We've got little Tommy, and there's still some people he hadn't met. So, how about this? This is funny. We're driving from Toronto, from Peterborough to Toronto, and we're going to a buddy's house for 9:30 in the morning, which is, like, unbelievable for me to be saying now that on a Sunday morning I'm going to be somewhere in Toronto at 9:30.
It's the new you.
It's the new me. It's the new dad. And we're going to visit, and we're almost at his place. We got a text message. Sorry, Mike. both kids are coughing and one of them might have croup. I don't know if you should come. But anyways, it was salvaged because we went out had some coffee and met up with some friends and then went to my folks' place and we hung out with my folks and went to my wife's mother's place. It was her birthday. So cool. We did that and then came all the way back home to Peterborough. So that's kind of the thing. We moved to Peterborough and it's like we're an hour away from home and we thought that was great. But then when you start factoring in all the traveling back and forth, it gets a little bit crazy at times.
And any awkward moments with the in-laws and the baby yet? Or
you know what? No.
Since you threw me under the bus with Lisa and soccer moms.
I'm not going to say there are any awkward moments. Actually, I found out some good news. I'm going to be going to see my very first World Junior game on Boxing Day. It's going to be Russia and Finland or something like that.
Wow.
So that's kind of cool.
At ACC then. Because Montreal, Toronto, right?
And
The Pete's are hosting some, or the Memorial Center is hosting a few exhibition games leading up to that.
Yeah, so I'm going to go check that out. But I will be honest, watching hockey, I have completely fallen off the map with the NHL in the last couple of years.
Right.
And it's because I'm a Leaf fan. And
you're a Washington Capitol fan too, right?
Well, yeah, absolutely.
And Philadelphia Flyer?
I'm only a fan of the Capitals around that 89 to 90 season.
Yeah.
You know, when I was, I was 8 years old. I remember it so vividly. But no, not at all. Anyways, but no, the NHL, it's kind of fallen off for me. I feel like there's just too many rules being taken away. And like, I love the fighting in the game and it's being taken
away.
There's
too many
as well.
Rules in general right now. Don't you think, Mike? Like in everyday society?
In everyday
Let's relax again. Hey, I have to ask you though, when you're going up the 150 and the 41, do you like check the weather first? are you more mindful of the weather, being a weather guy now?
You know what? And here's a funny story. People don't know this. Before I ever got into broadcasting, I was a landscaper for about 12 years. And I would do landscape construction in the summer and the fall. And in the winter, I was a snowplower. So I would check the weather all the time. And I'd learn about the weather and what system's coming and how much snow is going to be. Because you want to know, can I go out for a beer tonight?
Absolutely.
Or am I going to have to be driving a truck later? So you start learning about the weather. And then when I kind of moved into this.
Natural transition.
Yeah, it kind of clicked.
Snowplowman to a weather forecaster.
Yeah, but the 115, it doesn't matter what weather you look at. For some reason, that highway is cursed.
The blowing snow. They need to build a fence, like a real fortress.
They do. They need to do something. Heated highway or something like that, because it is unbelievable sometimes.
Yeah. I have to ask you, though, about, you know, when we go out around Peterborough and people see you like that with the weather guy, and a lot of them are like, how about that weather, Mike? And it's a sunny day, it's a cloudy day, but you're really obviously recognizable. Like, how has being a weatherman changed your life in any fundamental way?
Oh my god,
like did you ever imagine?
Well, I was always on radio, right? And sometimes you'd be at a checkout or something and someone would be like, hey, I recognize that voice and blah blah blah, but now it's like they recognize your face. So I went to see David Wilcox with a friend of mine, Ken Elric, who works over at the Wolf. He got me a spare ticket. We went and we checked him out, and I wasn't really into his music, but I was like, hey, free ticket, let's check him out. Yep. He's actually a really good guitar player. It was fun to watch. And then I was outside the venue after the show, and this guy just walks up to me, and this is like a common occurrence, like walks up to me, he's like, hey, you're that weather guy.
Yep.
I'm like, yeah, hey, how's it going? He's like, man, you suck. Just like right to my face. And I turn around, I'm like, well, what do you do? He's like, well, I don't really have, you know, Yeah, you suck.
You suck too.
You suck at your life.
You suck worse.
Yeah, no.
So when he says you suck, do you mean because your weather forecasts aren't accurate or just you?
I think
like you as a person.
You know what? And a lot of people say, well, it wasn't accurate. You didn't call, you know, there were 16 centimeters of snow on my house and you called for 15.
Right.
And that's ridiculous. You should know exactly how much snow is going to fall in my backyard at that time. I'm like, it's impossible. It's not going to happen. There's so many different variables that it's impossible because you get blowing snow. You might get more snow than your neighbor gets. I so far already this year, I had my driveway had like nothing on it. My neighbor was just covered in snow because it was the wind.
Right.
So, you know, I try my best to be as accurate as possible. I think I'm actually, running a pretty good.
I think you're all right.
My statistics are doing pretty good so far.
Do you ever get people calling the state to complain about your weather forecast that sunny when it was supposed to be?
But within like a couple of minutes of talking to me, they understand that, you know what, like meteorology is in its infancy.
Not an exact science, right?
It's not yet, and it's in its infancy. It hasn't been happening a lot for long enough. And just think back to the 80s, we just started using satellites to be able to get this imagery out there,
right?
We're still learning all about it. And then with global warming and the things that are transpiring with that and all the changes that are happening, it's really hard at times
Well, you really are into the weather.
Oh, it's my job. It's what I do. And you know what? A lot of weather analysts will just take what they see from Environment Canada and put it into their forecast. I don't do that. I look at Environment Canada. I look at several different outlets because we have subscription to Environment Canada. But then I run in my actual, like I go online. There are online tools or different forecast models.
You
I
will
run
those. Fact check things, basically.
Yeah, you go make through, sure you fact check, but then you check your own models and you look because you know what? A lot of these big agencies, they're not doing a specific forecast for Peterborough. They're doing a generalized one because they only have so many people.
Sure.
I have the opportunity to use every source I have to focus in on this one little area of the world and try and be a little more accurate. So that's what I try and pride myself on doing.
Have you ever done, have you ever thought of just doing, there's a 100% chance of cloud and there's a 100% chance of sun today? Like, if you ever and then just drop the mic.
Here, you want to hear tomorrow's forecast?
Yeah.
Okay, I haven't even looked at a forecast model this weekend. Tomorrow's forecast, you know what, we'll probably get a 30% chance of precipitation, which means that, you know what, there could be some precipitation, but it's not likely, but it could still happen. So if it happens, I called for a 30% chance of showers. So yeah, we're still looking good. However, that probably leaves out about a 70% chance of there not being showers, which is a pretty good chance. But if there's showers, hey, at least I called for that 30%. Now, we'll probably see a mostly cloudy...
What are you, a slam poet now?
We're going to see a mostly cloudy sky. Now, at the same time of seeing a mostly cloudy sky, that means you could see a little bit of sunshine, but for the most part, it's going to be mostly cloudy. Now, you said it was mostly cloudy all day, but hey, there was a little sunshine at a certain time when you weren't looking at the sky, and I know that that's when it happened. So my forecast is right. I am infallible. All right, PTBO Canada Live, Episode 1. Neil Morton, thank you again for joining me, and we have Ann Shebib coming up after this.
Thank you.
PTBO Canada Live is brought to you by Kawartha TV Stereo. You know, the great thing about Kawartha TV Stereo is that they have wonderful customer service. My baby went in there a little while ago because he wanted to upgrade his speaker stack because he likes listening to music. Well, they helped him and realized that, hey, I know this is a baby, and I could certainly take advantage of this baby and take him for everything he's got. But no, they didn't do that. They went in, they helped him get exactly what he needed, found the right little earplugs and earphones that these little ears need, and sold him the equipment that he wanted. And he got a great deal on it, and that's why we love Kawartha TV Stereo. Also, they provided us with our laptops, as well as a bunch of gear and the cameras that we use to record PTBO Canada Live with Mike Judson. Cheers.
Welcome back to PTBO Canada Live. Joining me now is... I don't even know who you are. Why are you here?
Oh, you just got me in off the street.
That's right. I was out on the street, and our real guest, I'm just kidding. joining me now is a wonderful girl, Ann Shebib. And Ann Shebib, I met you, I think at the first time that we met was at Spanky's.
Yeah. It definitely was.
It was definitely at Spanky's.
I think I did one of those, like, oh, I think that's a weatherman, so I'll probably just introduce myself.
Right.
For fun, and hope he remembers.
You were probably one of those people that was like, hey, you're the weatherman, right? I was like, yeah. And you're like, yeah, you suck.
No, I would never do that. And I can't believe people do that.
No. Oh, it's way worse than that. You know what the most common one is? It's like, well, geez, you look a lot fatter on TV than you do in person. And it's like, wow, you are almost handsome.
You're a real person. Like, you go home at night, and you're just like, oh, yeah, I am, like,
it's not,
okay, great, I'm fat.
You pay a cable bill, and because you pay that cable bill, it is your full license to run me through the ringer anytime you want, right? I cost you money. So
they're like, do you know the current on my taxes? I can do whatever I want.
And you got to understand, I'm also a millionaire, right?
Right.
Because I work at Chex TV in town. I'm a millionaire, so essentially you can say whatever you want. But anyways, there is a reason why I invited you here, and one of the interesting reasons is that apparently... Domino's Pizza down on Lansdowne Street is producing great talent for Peterborough.
Yeah, we do it in the back.
No pun intended, but you guys are essentially you started in this stand-up comedy. Now that's why I wanted to have you on. I was sent a video over Facebook of Ann Shebib doing her first comedy routine. I think it was at the Spill.
It was at the Spill.
Is at the Spill. Yeah. And the audio was really tough to hear because there were people talking. I guess someone was shooting with their cell phone.
I know, and I think they also didn't want to distract me, so it's like it's in their pocket half the time. But you can hear me, but that's pretty much it.
And you can hear everything you say. And I listened to that, and I was like, Ann Shebib, who I met at Spanky's, is doing stand-up comedy, and she is hilarious. And as soon as I heard that you were doing it, I said, well, this is a no-brainer, because every time I talk to you, you make me laugh. And so what drew you to finally dive in and start trying this? Like, because for me, it sounds terrifying.
It is absolutely terrifying. I first started doing it. Someone actually asked Ken from the Wolf to do it.
Yep.
And I was there and I was like, you should do it. I'll write your jokes. Like, and I've always been interested and I love watching stand up. And I just come from a, not to be cocky or anything, but a very funny family. Like, we're always joking around. Like, when we're together, that's material in itself. Anyways, and then so Ken's friend asked him, and I was there, and he's like, well, why don't you just do it? And I was like, okay, yeah, maybe. And I was kind of saying maybe, and I probably wasn't going to do it. And then when I replied back to him, I messaged him, and I was drunk, and I was like, I should do this. I'm really good.
A little liquid color.
Yeah, I was like, I make jokes good. And then...
did you agree to do it while you were drunk? Because that would be the worst wake-up hangover.
Yeah, I did. No, that was it. I was like, just talking to my family, and they're like, you're really funny. And I'm like, yeah, I know, obviously. And yeah, I just texted him, or I messaged him on Facebook, and... You're just like yeah, I'll try that out. And then the next day, I was just like, I got to write some jokes. Like, I got to figure out a process or how to do this or Google, like, how to be a stand-up comedian.
Yeah,
like,
because you didn't know how to do it. But
no, this is just me, like, and everyone asks me, how do you do it? And I'm like, okay, just take you and then just take you freaking out and have to go on stage and just prepare as much as you can and memorize and... It takes work. Like,
no, the memorization is the scary part for me. I'm like a weatherman. I go up, it's improv every night. I don't have to worry about what I'm going to say. I just have to know the facts and figures. But to be able to go up and memorize it. But another reason why I said Domino's is producing great talent is because Ken Elric is another person that we know. And he works. I think he still works there.
Yes, he does.
You got out.
Yeah, I worked there for 10 years. I started when I was 14.
Wow.
So... it's not, I don't know, I just kind of, I know all there is to know about pizza. I'm okay with that. And it was nice to go in and do my routine and then get out. And like, it's easy for me, but I wanted something new, a new challenge. And it was about my time to retire from Domino's. And I'm young, I don't know. And it was just kind of like embarrassing when I like see people from high school and they're like, oh, you're still at Domino's. And I'm like, yeah, I am.
It's tough.
Like, and it's not even like I have a super good job now. It's just like, I just wanted to switch it up.
Well, I was around your age when I finally like quit living at home with my parents and set sail off to the East Coast and started, you know, trying to discover what I wanted to do. Yeah. So, and then it led me to being the weatherman at Tech TV. So you have lots of great things ahead of you.
Yeah. Well, I'm in school at the same time. This is just like, I'm just changing up my part-time.
What are you doing at school?
Health information management.
That's not funny.
I know. It has nothing. It's I was just saying. It's complete opposite ends of the spectrum. But
that's that is not funny at all.
Yeah, so, but I can find funny things and things that aren't necessarily funny right off the bat. Right.
Fair enough. Now, when we go back to that first night at the Spill, what were you channeling to go up on stage? Like, you know that. For me, the only thing I can equate it to is the first time I went on air and did the weather, and it was awful. I was probably sweating in places that were probably showing up on camera. For you, what was it like when you first came on?
So before, I very much believe in being confident in your own jokes, because if you're trailing off at the end and the audience can see that, they're not going to laugh. Like, they're going to be like, that girl has no idea what she's doing. So I just went up. I prepared. Like hours and hours of just like doing it over in my car. I have to be alone. I don't want anyone to hear the jokes before. Like
in your car.
Yeah. Not.
Did you have the rearview mirror down, like looking at yourself?
Like, I look good right now. No, but I would park in any parking lot and just go over it, because I don't want my brother to hear it, and then it'll be different when I do it on stage or something.
Right.
So I guess I am over preparing, but I'm improvising a little bit where I know the jokes that I'm going to do. I get up there. Anyways, when I went up, I was like, while I was walking in the front, they introduced me, and I was like, oh my God, this is going to be awful. Like, this is not going to go well, but I have to get used to it. I'm going to do it. And once I got up there, it was like clear mind. I was able to say all my jokes with the right timing. It worked out. Like, it could have been bad, but it was amazing. It went really well.
It was really funny. So and so you move away from that, and you left with a positive vibe. Have you done shows since then?
I've done a couple shows since then.
Right.
Yeah.
Did they go as well?
Yeah, like just as well. I didn't get like a negative, but it's all my friends and family, right? But then there's some other people, and I've even had people come up to me after that I've never met, And they're just like, you did a really good job. Like, you sounded just like the people on the TV.
on the TV.
But yeah, it went as well as it could go.
So I love it. So it's from pizza to being a comedian now. And where do you see yourself going? Because I know you're in school, but you know what? Like, school sucks, right? Like, you don't want to be
it's
in school.
It's awful. Yeah. It's always awful.
Like why are you doing this to yourself when you could just be sitting at home honing your craft and trying to travel the world?
I don't know. It's probably just to, like, tell my mother I'm doing something other than comedy, even though she knows I'm funny. And, like, right. She hasn't been to a show yet, which is fine. But it's only because I don't tell her when it is, because I don't want her to be like, I'll do my jokes and then I'll come off stage and she'll be like, man, that was really bold. Like,
So tell me a little bit about your family. How big is it?
I have two older brothers and two older sisters.
You the baby?
Yeah.
Oh,
of course.
Baby Shebib. Yeah. Well, of course you're funny because the babies get all the attention, right?
Yeah. Well, you'd think so. But after five, like, the rules kind of, well, in a good way, they kind of go down the hill. Like, I never believed in Santa Claus, you know? Like, because it was just like, they forgot to, like, build that up for me. They'd be like, oh, Santa's coming. I'm like, what, you mean Grandpa?
Grandpa's putting on that.
Is Grandpa coming over later? Is that what you mean? Like, I've never, yeah.
Shebib, where does that come from?
It's Lebanese.
It's Lebanese.
Yeah.
So, but you're born in Canada here?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was like my great grandpa came from Lebanon.
Right.
And so my dad looks kind of Lebanese, but I'm very, very white.
You are pretty white. Now, do you have an affinity for shawarma? Because it's very popular.
It's delicious, and there isn't enough of it in Peterborough.
No. Well, you know what? I do like what Ariana does over there. I think they have great shawarma. Yeah. There are a couple shawarma places, few places you can get a shawarma or falafel, but I'm glad to hear that at least that trickled down from Lebanon.
Yeah, that donair sauce.
So tell me a little bit about Ken Elric.
So we met at Domino's.
So you did. I was talking to my wife on the way over. Yeah. I'm like, I don't know if they met at Domino's.
It was a little bit of, I worked at the Park Hill store for 9 years and then I switched over the last year or whatever. And he came to my store to cover a shift once and, I was like, oh, he's pretty cute. And then just like never really thought about it again. And then we saw each other at a party and I added him on Facebook and it was just like, hey.
Oh, hey. No.
You like this?
There's no Tinder needed for that, eh?
No. And I've always, like, not to make myself sound slutty or anything, but I've been in, I'm a very much a long-term relationship girl, so it's like,
right. That I've does never not even sound had, slutty at
all. Yeah. I've never really had to go on Plenty of Fish or Tinder or anything, so I'm like, I can't even believe it's a thing. Like, and everyone's pretending they're okay with it, or they actually are okay with it, but you're literally judging a book by its cover. Like,
you're looking at a picture and you're going, yeah, I'd do that.
Yeah.
And then you hit a thing.
He doesn't look like he'll be a good father. Like,
it's so weird. So, and anyone doesn't know Ken Elric, it's Dr. Patchbeard over at The Wolf, The Cruise. Yeah. And so you guys met at Domino's. You didn't think anything much of it except for, like, he's cute.
Yeah.
And I look at him, I'm like, he's cute and furry. I like this guy. And,
yeah.
But you know what the funny thing is that I knew Ken from Bob FM and Lindsay when he was an intern, and I was just starting there as an announcer. Mm-hmm. And I remember through the years, as we were hanging out more and more, that Ken would talk about this girl at Domino's a couple of times. He was telling me. And then I revisited this with him maybe about 3 or 4 weeks ago. And I was like, was that Ann you were talking about? He's like, yeah, it totally was.
Yeah, it was mostly because he was... like, we started talking on Facebook or whatever, where all love spread. Like, you and Jen, you just added each other on Facebook, and then you're like, let's get married.
Mm-hmm.
So, he started...
That's how it works.
Yeah. So, we were just talking. He was always doing the early shift on Sunday mornings, and that's when I was hungover, and I'd always wake up at around, like, 8, and be like, where's water now? And so, then I just, like, pop on Facebook and see him on there, and then we just started talking, and we're like, you want a date?
Is that how it worked? Did you ask him out or did he ask you out? I think you totally
asked him out. I don't
think
that really... No one does that. And no one's like, do you want to go steady with me? It was just like, we did the hangouts and then we're just like, I guess we're dating. Like,
am I just old? I gave Jen my Letterman jacket first.
Yeah.
She wore that and then I gave her a promise ring.
Yeah, like if you're over 30, like you're going to die soon.
Well, that was eye-opening.
Yeah. Well, it's out there, right?
So. It's out there. I'm going to die sooner than you. Maybe. My thought on that is, well, you can always get hit by a bus, so YOLO.
Right? Is that your motto? Do you love YOLOing?
No, I don't. My motto in life, and I was talking about this a little while ago.
Do you know what
ago.
YOLO means?
You like only live once.
Enough? Oh, okay.
Yeah. And Ken is your bae.
Oh, yeah, bae.
Yeah. And when you guys are together, it's totally turn.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. So I'm done with the lingo. Yeah, you're totally true.
You get it.
No, my motto is, and this is what I tell myself, and it's probably a negative motto to have, but I always say when something bad happens, I always look at myself, I'm like, well, worse things have happened to better people.
Exactly.
Right? Makes me feel worse about myself, but better about the situation.
Yeah. Because I'm not necessarily, like, the best person, so, you know.
Yeah, I mean, like, you think, like, well, there's Nelson Mandela. He was way better than me, as far as I know. And so worse things certainly happened to him than me. So I'm like, well, at least I'm not Nelson Mandela locked up in an African prison forever.
And you're not always like in the public and everyone knows that.
That's right.
Yeah.
And so, you know what? Life can always be a little bit better.
I had a question about your little weatherman thing. I saw that you can.
Little weatherman.
I'm interviewing you now.
Okay. Yeah. What do you got?
So I see that you like take... people send in pictures, their kids send in pictures.
Right.
Like, what's the age range? Like,
I am. Okay.
If I did up a doodle,
I am not.
Could I get that it on TV?
Yes, you could. But I'm going to say one thing is that I've seen some of your doodles before. And I'm not going to describe what they are, but they are sometimes on the inside of pizza boxes sent to your friends. And I've been at the parties when you open up the pizza box. Oh, let's take a look at the pizza. Oh, my goodness. There's something interesting drawn in this pizza box.
I know. And we can talk about this now because I don't work there anymore.
You're talented. You're a talented artist.
I know.
It was the veins. It was just terrifying.
I know. And I just like... close my eyes and I just draw whatever I see whenever I close my eyes.
That is terrifying. Ken's
my
a lucky
life is
man.
A nightmare.
Well, I have to thank you very much for coming
on
the podcast.
Thank you for having me.
Everyone, this is Ann Shebib. She does comedy locally around Peterborough, hopefully all over the country and the world soon. I have faith in you, Ann.
You
are
you.
A
thank
very
you for
funny
having
girl.
Me.
And we're going to post a YouTube video along with a link and everything so that you can at least hear your comedy. And then there's going to be all these other people who are going to hear your comedy. And then hopefully that's going to work in your favor.
All right.
Thank you
again. Thank you very much.
We've got John Juice coming up after the break.
PTBOCanada Live with Mike Judson is brought to you by, guess what? PTBOCanada.com. And if you haven't checked out their awesome list yet this year, you should. Every year they go through and they pick out some of their most favorite stories of the year. And I know one special little guy that made the list. It was me. It was me. I made the awesome list. That's right. He did make the awesome list. Because he's awesome. And so is PTBOCanada.com. And maybe this podcast.
Welcome back to PTBO Canada Live. Very excited, and you were one of the first people that I thought of when we decided to go ahead and start doing this podcast of people from the community that we wanted to showcase and talk to. Really. And if you don't know them, I put together like shot sheets on you, but I've lost them. I think they're in my pocket. So he's a former NHL player. You used to play in the Europe leagues. You're a former or probably still a pedal for Hoper. Also, Pink of the Rink. There's a million things that you've done. You played for the Washington Capitals. You played for the Philadelphia Flyers. You played for the Winnipeg Jets. And you also played for the Los Angeles Kings.
That's right.
You had I don't know.
I wasn't even a broadcaster.
You were even, and you worked for Rogers Sportsnet.
That's right.
This is John Druce. And you know what? You were one of the first former NHL players that I met and knew you before I met. And had a beer with you, and I sat there and I played it so cool. We're at Spanky's where I'm just having a drink. I'm like, oh yeah, it's just John Truth, no big deal. I'm like, really, I'm wetting my pants. But at the same time, very cool for meeting you, and thank you for coming on the podcast.
Thanks for having me. I really appreciate you having me on the show.
Absolutely. Now, John, I want to talk to you. First of all, I want to start off. You're living in Peterborough.
I am. I'm born and raised in Peterborough.
See, that's what I wanted to ask you. Yeah. I didn't know whether or not you were born and raised here.
No, it's a fantastic place to grow up and play minor hockey. I mean, you think about all the people that have come from Peterborough that have made it to the NHL. I was just one of the fortunate ones, and I got to play for the hometown Peterborough Pizza as well.
That must have been crazy for you.
It was unbelievable. I mean, I grew up watching these guys as kids. They were my idols.
Isn't it weird how the Peets in Peterborough, it's almost like it's an NHL team here. Like, people follow the Peets like crazy here.
Well, you know, when I was playing, we had some amazing winning teams. And
right.
I mean, the players,
who were on those teams?
Kay Whitmore, Ron Tugnutt, Chris King, Randy Bridge, Terry Karkner, Glenn Seabrook. Let me see.
Wow.
Jody Hall.
Jody.
Yeah, Luke Richardson.
Wow. Oh, Luke was he was a favorite of mine when I was growing up.
Unbelievable. We had so many good players. It was ridiculous. The year I got drafted, we had 11 guys drafted off our team.
Wow.
Never, unheard of.
And you got drafted, and you got drafted in 1985 to the Washington Capitals, yeah. And you went 40th in the draft.
Is that what it was? Yeah. second round. I thought it was 42nd, but maybe it was 40th. I don't even know.
Oh, you don't even know?
I don't even think about that stuff. I was so nervous that day. Are you kidding me?
That's what I wanted to ask you. What is it like when you're like this young kid who can barely sprout a hair on your face, and you're sitting there, and you're on television, and you've got all these like these incredible hockey teams around you? It's like, is someone going to pick me or what?
Yeah, it was pretty surreal experience. I was sitting there, and Washington had talked to me a little bit during the season, and when they were about to be up for the next pick, I was looking at their table, and I thought to myself, I'm going now. This is when I'm going. And sure enough, they announced my name. I go down, and we get our picture taken, jersey on, and everything like that, and then they're like, you know, who should we take next? And then Rob Murray was a line mate of mine. We played together quite a bit. Defensive line, penalty killing, things like that. I said, well, you should take Rob Murray. Sure enough, who do they pick? Rob Murray.
Really?
It was unbelievable.
Murray ended up, oh no, I'm thinking Glenn Murray. He ended up playing for Boston.
Rob played some games in the NHL.
Yeah.
But like 1,000 in the American League. And he's coaching now in the American League.
And that's where you started. You started in the American League.
In Binghamton, that's right.
In Binghamton. And I think you went a few years, and you were just kind of getting your feet. And then one year you had this breakout year in Binghamton, and the Capitals decided we got to bring this kid up.
I started in Binghamton, played 2 years there. And it was a struggle, you know, it was a big adjustment. I mean, I grew up, lived at home when I was here, so I never really had that experience being away from home.
Right.
So it was all new being away. And then those first couple of years were great learning experiences, and we went through a lot of adversity. And it was tough playing in the American League. It was not an easy travel schedule, and it was just ridiculous. We'd be at home Friday night in Newmarket, Saturday night, and back and play an afternoon game in Binghamton on 12 o'clock noon on Sunday. So, I mean, it was tough. It was a tough schedule.
Yeah, you really have to slog it out in the trenches before you can make it anywhere near an NHL team.
That's right. And then you start playing in the NHL, and you hear these guys complaining that started in the NHL about the travel schedule. I'm like, you guys got to be kidding me.
You guys got to be kidding me. And complaining about the pay, too. But, you got picked up by, you were on the farm team, and then you got brought up by the Capitals. And you started playing, and, you know, I looked you up on Wikipedia. I don't know if you've read your wiki page.
No.
No?
No.
Oh, I think it's flash forward. We're going to go to the 89-90 year because this is your year.
Yeah.
This is the year of the Druce. And I think it said in 45 games, John Druce had 8 goals and something and 45 points and was relatively unspectacular. They used the word unspectacular, which I'm like, that's not very nice. But either way, unspectacular. And then exploded for 14 goals in the playoffs. Now, I know this is like the claim to fame for you. This is what you hear about all the time. And if you ever go back to Washington, and it's true, you go back there, you're still regarded as a hero to these guys.
They're fantastic when I go back. I love it. You know, the thing about it, 14 goals in 15 games, right? And I scored 8 in the regular season. Think about that.
That's crazy.
In 48 games. But I wasn't playing. There was a huge difference. I wasn't playing a lot. I was playing third line, fourth line, in the press box. You know, you're young. You're getting developed. It was my second year. I had a crappy training camp and started the season out in the minors, actually, played 10, 15 games. So the opportunity, when it came, was at perfect timing. The season had just... finishing up the season, I felt really good.
Right.
I think... Terry Murray told me, he was my coach at the time, we're going into Philadelphia, and he told the reporters before the game, he said, John Druce is going to score tonight. He's had a great week this week, and sure enough, I score a goal. Then the playoffs start. We're playing the first round against New Jersey. Dino Cicerelli scores 8 goals in that series, and I get 2. I'm playing third, fourth line.
Right? Yeah.
Big fight with Ken Danico that series as well. So that was...
You did?
Yeah, I did.
You weren't regarded as a fighting player.
Well, I could take care of myself. In junior, I fought some really tough guys.
Yeah.
And so it gave me a little bit more room.
How did that Danico fight? He's a tough customer.
Well,
how did that go?
After the playoffs were over, I was talking to Dale Hunter, who was a roommate of mine for 2.5 years. We used to room on the road for, you know, and play on the same line with him all the time. He says, you know, Druce, he says, the one thing that got me going that wanted me to play even more is when you fought Ken Danico. And I was like, really? He goes, that meant more to me than the 14 goals you scored. Right. So,
wow.
Yeah. And then, oh, so anyway, so the next series, we play the Rangers.
Right.
Dino Cicerelli gets his knee blown out by Chris King.
Right.
So I get a chance to play with Dale and Jeff Courtnell.
Insane. Okay.
So I end up scoring 9 goals in that series.
Wow. Who was feeding you the opportunities?
You know what? It was just a lot of hard work. Go to the net, get rebounds. If I wasn't on my ass, I wasn't doing my job, basically.
That's the thing. I think your coach said, the coach was interviewed, and I saw a clip from it. And he's like, you know what? The last person we thought to come out and have this explosion, this breakout playoff series, was John Druce. But he came in like a hero. And it was because he told you, you know what, if you're not on your ass in front of that net, if you're not working as hard as you can to get to the front and get to the corners, then you're not doing your job. Now, one thing I want to ask you is, as an NHL player, when you're doing those things, when you're in the corner, when you're in front of the net, and you're just having a tough time, and you know, maybe the puck's not going in, does it ever feel almost like a 9-to-5 job for you? Does it feel like, you know,
oh, it's so tough.
What's it
like? It is so tough, day in, day out. You think about it, you play in over 80 games a year. All of a sudden, that year it was up to almost 100 games. And you're, and okay, so you're talking about the rules of hockey now and the way it used to be?
Yeah.
I could play 15 years, 20 years now. Like, I mean, seriously.
They protect the players.
You couldn't touch anybody. Now, back then, you try to get to the front of that, you're being cross-checked, slashed, hooked. You know, might as well just give them a rope and let them tie you up out front. Like, I mean, it was that bad. You had to fight every inch to get where you had to go.
And for a fan, we watch TV. And what I don't think a lot of people understand is that you're coming home from your hard day's work, and you're sitting down to watch this and relax, and then you're screaming and yelling at these guys, you're a bum, you're a bum. But imagine this guy was at your work watching you make mistakes at work. You're a bum,
right.
Because you're working your job and putting your body on the line.
That's right. Every day was, you know, I don't care what you did for me yesterday. I don't care what you did for me last shift. What can you do for me the next shift?
Right.
Right? And if you're not playing well, you're sitting in the press box.
Now, you know, you had this huge breakout, and you guys went far in that playoff run.
Yeah, we went to the semifinals. We lost out to Boston, unfortunately.
I hate the Bruins.
But that was the year Edmonton won it, and I think Peter Klima scored an overtime goal. He hadn't played in, like, 3 periods or something.
It but didn't you tie some record with, like, Yari Curry and someone else? It was...
Well, what did I have? I think 7 power play goals, maybe?
It was 9. You had 9 goals.
9 in, power play goals?
Yeah, or was in one series.
Oh, 9 goals in one series. Was that the record?
Yeah, and you tied. You were like tied somewhere with Yari Curry and someone
else. Oh, very cool. Because I played with Yari in L.A.
Really?
I was so fortunate. I got to play with so many great players.
You got to play with Wayne Gretzky.
Wayne Gretzky, Yari Curry, Charlie Huddy. Like, these guys all won like...
Best player you ever played with?
Yari Curry.
Yari Curry?
Yari Curry.
Really?
Yari Curry was an unbelievable player.
You know what? And he had hands. He had finesse.
Okay, so get this. Okay, Yari Curry scored 72 goals when he was in Edmonton playing with Wayne Gretzky.
Yeah.
So they were playing together in Los Angeles. So Yari and I, when we were on the road, we always used to go to dinner together the night before the game. Him, myself, and Robert Lang. So one night, Yari's complaining. He's like, I can't score any goals. Like, you know, and I don't know what I'm not doing or whatever. So all I remember as watching Yari when I was younger was, like, he'd score all these one-timers, and Gretz would feed him, and he'd shoot the puck all the time.
Right.
Well, now he's playing with Gretz. He's the first one in the forecheck. He's playing low on our own end, all the things that Gretz was supposed to be doing as a centerman, right? So, and then he started trying to pass the puck to everybody.
Right.
So I looked at Yari. I said, you scored 72 goals, and you're asking me what to do to score goals? I said, what were you doing when you scored those goals? Do you remember? He goes, not really. I said, Yari, all I remember is and visualize you shooting the puck every second you had. And he goes, yeah, you're right. I need to shoot the puck more. If you don't shoot, you don't score, Yari.
And that's the thing, right?
But, I mean, these guys, these high elite caliber players that even they're questioning themselves. You know, we're all human out there. We're all out there trying to do our best. And sometimes when guys struggling, you know, it's just these little things that you're not thinking of because you're thinking about everything else.
But it's hard to connect as a fan when you're watching the game and being like, oh, he must be having a hard time, you know. But there are certain players that were just, they must have been tough to play with or against for you. But, like, you know, that were just like vilified by fans as well. Did you have anyone come to mind that was just like a tough guy to play against? You just hated playing him?
Oh, gee. A guy like Rick Tockett.
Really?
Yeah.
Rick Tockett, eh?
He was so tough to play against. He, just because he's so aggressive. Like, if he wasn't playing nasty, he wasn't doing his job.
Right.
You know, he ended up scoring a lot of goals. But to get to that point, to get that room, he was nasty. We got in a fight one night in Washington. And I was still trying to make the team. And so we get in a fight. It's an exhibition game. We go to the penalty box, and he's yelling at me. And he's like, and we both went down. We both fell down. He's like, stand up. And I looked at him. I said, Talk, if all I got to do is fight you every night to stay in this league, then I'll be all right. And he looked at me. He's like, nice. That's good. And we ended up playing together in Los Angeles. So
that's awesome.
Yeah.
You say Yari Curry, 72 goals. You were there when Timu Solani scored like what
76.
76 goals. You were on that team. And was Ty Domi on that team too?
He came in later that year, yes.
So you played with Ty a little bit as well?
Yeah.
And that must have been a crazy year for you guys.
Oh, man. You know, it was a shock initially to get traded. I guess I got picked up on waivers.
Yeah.
But getting there and then seeing the talent that they had, like Timu Solani was one of the quickest players I've ever seen from start. Like, just hit top speed, like, so fast.
Yeah.
At that time. And he was playing with a guy, Alexei Zhyamnov.
Right.
So now Alexei, you couldn't take the puck off Alexei. So what a combination to be able to hit a guy like Timu when he was open or hit him with speed. I don't know how many times we've been sitting there on the bench watching Timu go down the wing, and I'm like, the D's got him. And then he'd turn it on and just blow by these guys. And I'd never seen anything like that before. And to see him score 76 goals, like I had front row seats.
Yeah, that's crazy.
I wasn't good enough to play on his line, so I got to watch it all.
And what's that like? Like the whole line system, like being able to see these guys play, but never get to play on their lines.
Well, here's a good example. I played with Gretz one game, and we're breaking out of our own end. He was high at our blue line, and I had the puck, and I started to get a good head of steam going. So I'm flying, and I see Gretz is open, but I'm thinking, I'll just carry it. I mean, I got lots of speed going here, right?
Yeah.
So I ended up going to the far blue line, and it was offside. And so I could tell he wasn't happy. So we go back to the bench, and he goes, Druce, just give me the puck. And I'm like, sorry, Gretz, I don't really see the ice as well as you do. I knew he was there, but it was just like, I should have just give it to him.
It's next time, just give it to Gretz.
Just give me the puck, Druce. And I was like, okay.
So like nowadays, we look at the rules of hockey, and it looks, and I was saying this earlier in the show, that I'm finding it hard to watch the NHL now. I think back to, I mean, for me, my glory days of watching NHL hockey were the 92-93 series. I'm a Leaf fan, and watching those guys, Gilmore and Clark, out there and, you know, doing their thing, and it was chippy. It was, you know, there was hooking. You could do all these things. There was more fighting. Now I feel like that is all kind of left the game, and it's left strictly to speed and finesse, which is beautiful at one point, but I like the chippiness of hockey.
So do I. I miss it. I don't watch hockey. It's very rare I'll sit down and I'll watch a hockey game like now. Maybe in the playoffs. I loved the playoffs last year. LA is my team. When they won their first cup a few years ago, I picked them before the season started, and I picked them last year as well.
Yeah.
But the chippiness, like, you look at the players in their team, like Mike Richards and even Kopitar. Like, yeah. You don't expect how tough he plays. Dustin Brown, Jarrett Stoll. Like, these guys right there willing to sacrifice and hit, right? But when I played, it was, you're right, we had that chippiness and there was that aggressiveness and the tenacity, and that's missing. And I wish the Leafs would win, because I'm sick of people complaining how bad they are.
You know, I had to turn it off after that Boston series where they were up 4-1 in the third. And after that, I said, you know what? You've broken my heart too many times. I had to sit there and really weigh my values. I had to say, why am I subscribing to a broken heart every year?
Yeah.
So until they get better, I'm not watching. I can't do it to myself, John.
I don't blame you. No, I don't blame you one bit.
So how often do you go back to Washington?
Let's see. I went back last year.
Yeah.
They had a convention. They started this a few years ago. They have a convention in, just before training camp starts.
Right.
Well, actually, when training camp starts, right around that time. And so what they do is they bring about 5,000 season ticket holders in, and they have this big convention. They sign autographs, bring alumni guys in, the big current players in. It's a whole huge, whole big thing, convention, right? So last year we went in, played an alumni game of our own. So the old guys played against each other.
Right.
It was great. We had about 3,000 fans out of this small area in this rink, and it was fantastic. And took Spanky with me.
Right.
And another buddy, and we ended up playing golf at Congressional. the Friday night, we took in the Caps exhibition games. Saturday morning, went to the convention, signed some autographs. Saturday night, we were at the Nationals baseball game, and Sunday, went to the Redskins game.
Wow,
so
that's awesome.
It was a great boys' weekend. It was such a good time. But it's just, it's so nice to go back there.
And out there, they have a thing. It's called, okay, who's going to pull a Druce this year? Yeah. We need someone to pull a Druce. I've heard this this speech coming offline. I can find it.
Well, you think about... it's been, what, 24 years, I guess?
Yeah.
Since I did that.
Since you pulled a Druce.
So that is my calling card. And yeah. I used to say, geez, I did more than that. I played 10 years in the NHL. You know, I played over 10 years. And then I realized this, well, that's a pretty good thing to be remembered for.
Yeah.
So as a calling card. But yeah, so, and I still get calls from people in the media every year.
Yeah.
Which is, think about it, that's like 24 years.
But you're such a well-spoken and handsome, intelligent man.
Well, thank you very much, Michael.
You should be. why aren't you doing more broadcasting?
You know what? I love broadcasting. I was doing color commentating for Sportsnet, and I was fortunate enough to do 5 Memorial Cups, an American League Championship game, and Montreal Canadiens package. I really enjoyed it. Unfortunately, my daughter got really sick at that point, so I couldn't be on the road. So... had to deal with more important family matter things. So that was, you know.
It is. And speaking of Courtney, this is something that, you know, I've had, I've talked with you before. We've done events together in regards, and I've had Courtney on Czechs Television as well to talk about it. And I got to say, you looking through the window into your family and what's going on with you two, your father-daughter relationship, it really is a beautiful thing.
Yeah, she's an amazing kid. I mean, we've always been close. I mean, I have another daughter, Natalie, as well, and I'm close with her. But Courtney and I mean, we've gone through so much.
Yeah.
She moved back with me here to Canada when she was 15, and so she was diagnosed with leukemia basically 6-7 months later, and it's just been a battle ever since, right? But no, our relationship is it's pretty special. You know, we've gone through a lot of things together. Pink in the Rink last year.
Right.
You know, co-chaired that last year, I guess we called co...
I was there.
Yeah, it was fantastic. What a great experience. You know, and to have her beside me out there, and it wasn't about me, it was about her.
It was about...
Yeah, absolutely, really. And I was just so happy to be there and have her there beside me.
And, I mean, having, like, a guy who has been through that adversity and has had to work hard for what he wants, I mean, you must have pearls of wisdom, and you must have passed over some of that tenacity over to her, because, I mean, look at her now, right?
I'll tell you what, she helped me get through a lot of it.
Wow.
That's the truth.
Yeah.
Yeah. She was unbelievable. She was worrying about me half the time when she was laying in the bed there, and it was... pretty special.
Being a hockey player, being an NHL guy, do you find that it's hard to really be emotional, to deal with your emotions? Because you're wrapped up in that locker room behavior.
And... Oh, I'm a softy.
Are you?
Just a big softy. I'm a teddy bear.
Yeah.
Wait a second. If anybody has any problems, I'll back you up. I got your back.
Yeah, how do you... you will back me up, because look at you. You're still in fantastic shape at, what, 48 years old now?
Yeah, yeah. I skate a couple times a week. I don't do near enough what I should to stay in shape. I'm actually feeling it this year.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This year more than others?
Yeah, pretty much, yeah. Last year was the start of it. I was thinking, man, I must be getting old because I'm starting to feel it when I'm skating. But I'm skating with the young guys still, and it's still a high tempo. It's still a lot of fun. I enjoy it.
But you also pedal a lot, because you do the pedal for Hope every year. You're the only guy on Pedal for Hope that is not a police officer.
That's right. I'm an honorary police officer. I actually have a uniform.
Can you take me down right now? Like, can you book me?
You know what? I didn't get a badge, though. Give me a gun or a badge. All the cool stuff. So I got a great uniform, though.
I'll get you a gun. Just kidding.
Got connections, right?
No, I have no connection. But, no, that's really cool. And is there anything else that you're working on for the future in Peterborough?
You know what? I just spend my time... the two things I love doing is playing hockey in the wintertime and playing music with my band.
And your band's name is Mud Filter. I've seen you play at the Backyard Against over on Hunter Street.
Yeah.
I think I may have called you once Corky and the Druce Pigs.
I've had Mud Flap, Mud Fish.
Mud Flap.
Yeah.
Are you guys thinking about a name change?
Yeah, I'd like to change our name. I think we all do. We're all looking to change our name. What do you think about the Neighborhoodlums?
The Neighborhoodlums. That's not bad. And I mean,
something different.
It is something different. And one of the coolest things that I've heard is that when you left the NHL, you paid 10 years in the NHL and then you went over to Europe. You played on a team that was owned, was it the lead singer of the Scorpions?
Well, the Scorpions, I'm not sure who exactly owned the team, but they were part of it. Mm-hmm. But it was funny because when I was over there, I loved playing guitar, but I wasn't going to ship my guitar over to Germany.
Right.
And Rudolf Schenker's son, the lead guitarist of the Scorpions was around quite a bit. So I said, do you think you get one of your dad's guitars and I could just play it, you know, for the year? And sure enough, he brought me an amazing acoustic guitar, just sat around and jammed on it all winter long. It was amazing.
That's really cool.
So, yeah, I played one of the Scorpions guitars.
So that's just another amazing thing that you can add to your career.
Well, you know what? I'm pretty fortunate. I was thinking about that the other day. I've played in the NHL. I got the broadcast. I've business owner. I'm in a band. All the things that I've actually really wanted to do growing up and through my life. And I'm thinking that's
you're a business owner.
Pretty cool. Yeah, I own a graphics company, large format digital printing. So basically. If you're around town, you see the buses that are wrapped, like the OLG bus or the Peach Lakers, the Pete's windows. We do vinyl graphics on vehicles, vehicle wraps, walls, windows, floors. We have designers in-house. We have all our printing in-house. And yeah,
that's very cool. So you should wrap my vehicle with the PTBO Canada Live podcast logo.
That would be amazing. I think that's a great idea, actually.
Oh, okay. Here we go.
No, then you can. It's constant 24/7 advertising. Yeah. Everybody's going to know that at 3:00 on Sunday you're going to be in here doing your podcast, and they can show up, and all of a sudden you're going to start having an audience.
But like,
and then you're going to have an audience, more of an audience on the air as well.
You betcha. Okay, you know what? I think it's a good idea. Well, we should talk about
this. So, to the man.
Hey, you haven't sold anything yet. You still have some closing questions
okay,
to do.
Okay.
But either way, John Druce, you have been an amazing person in this community just for everything that you do with Pedal for Hope and recently with Pink in the Rink. And, of course, you play all these alumni games. You just played one last at the Memorial
last night,
Center.
Last night at the Memorial Center,
night with, and that was in support of Special Olympics.
That's right.
Yeah. How important is it for you to get out and do these charitable acts?
I love it. I mean, just being asked and to be involved is something that's special. I mean, some of the things I've made an effort to, with the Pedal for Hope, I made an effort to, through the Cancer Society, to meet the police officers. Now I'm best of friends with all of them. And to be a part of that. And they brought me in as a non-police officer, which was surprising.
Right.
And so they've treated me like their own, which is amazing. But, you know, all these events, the alumni game, the Pink in the Rink, golf tournaments, all those things. I just love being a part of it. If I can help and give back anyway, like, I mean, this is a community that helped me become who I am and give me a shot to play in the NHL, play with the Beats.
Yeah.
So I feel pretty fortunate about that.
Well, we're happy to have you here, and thanks, and obviously happy to have you here at Riley's and supporting the podcast. And I'm gonna see you around town at some point.
Of course.
Yeah.
Now, did you say you had some for Publican House or something like that?
Yeah, that's right. I do have an ad copy that I want you to
read.
You
do, right?
So this is it's something that we do with all the guests here. It's with Publican House Brewery. Now I've written it just for you. Okay. So
all right.
So the beer, which is what we're featuring right here, it's called 8 or Better.
8 or Better.
That's the name of the beer.
All right.
8 or Better. All right. So it says begin reading down here.
Begin reading. All right. So what's the difference between John Druce in his 20s playing in the NHL, wet behind the ears, inexperienced in the ways of love, and the John Druce that sits before you today? Well, today's John Druce is a better, more refined man, especially after having sipped on Publican House 8 or Better. 8 or Better is only brewed once a year, and the name has nothing to do with how many goals I scored or the 89 playoffs in the Washington Capitals. So just so you know, I scored 9 goals. I was a hero, damn it. No, it reflects the alcohol percentage, which is usually 8 or better. Pretty strong, but not as strong as me. Go ahead and tuck into one of these great Belgian-style beers and think about the days when old Drucey boy was out there getting her done. Lord knows I do.
Thank you very much. John Druce for Publican House, John Druce for PTBO Canada Live. Thank you very much for joining
thanks
us.
Thanks for having me.
All right.
Appreciate it.
We're going to finish up in just after this.
PTBO Canada Live is brought to you by Maars Music. They helped us out when we were first starting this podcast and helped us get some equipment together, including all the mixers and mic set and stuff that we need. But if you're a musician in town or someone who just needs good sound, you know all about Maars Music. These guys are the last bastion of local help when it comes to sound and music. And yeah, it's a place that you should probably go and check out. And they are very knowledgeable, very helpful, and very nice. So head on over to Maars Music on George Street in Peterborough.
Oh, do you hear that?
Oh, my goodness.
Oh.
Oh, let's do the entire interview like this.
I was watching, what do you call it, Christmas Vacation, and his wife goes, so, do you hear something? That you couldn't hear a dump truck driving through a nitroglycerin plant.
Thank you. That's one of my... All right, welcome back to PTBO Canada Live. I'm Mike Judson, and joining me now, rhymes with John Juice, drink a glass of juice, the moose is loose. That's as far as I'm going to go with that. Yep. Kate LaDuce. Is it LaDuce?
Yes.
Okay, and is that your real name?
No.
No? Okay. Is it Chinese, or...
My name?
Yeah.
Very Ukrainian. So Ukrainian that I had to change it.
I like Kate LaDuce. It sounds absolutely beautiful. And more so, in terms of beauty, is the voice and the music that you guys have been creating. So you are a piece of Robot Eyes.
Yes.
And I have been watching. And if you haven't seen Robot Eyes on YouTube yet, please go out and check it out. Because I listened to it. Well, first of all, I think you guys did the Hootenanny.
Yes.
Yes. And I was the MC. I don't know if you remember me
introducing
you. And we hung out in the back a little while as well. And I went out and I listened to Robot Eyes. Very 80s in terms of, it reminded me of things like The Cult, a little bit of the psychedelic Furs. Is there anything in there? Am I right on that?
I was just, the things you were listing, I was thinking of the records on my wall. I was like, yeah, that's there.
Yeah,
that's there.
Psychedelic Furs was one of the most striking things because I grew up with it. My dad was a huge fan. So I heard your sound. I was like, this is the Furs to me. It's what I'm hearing, and it's awesome. And you guys are recapturing the sound, but you're adding a modern twist to it that really is quite interesting. And that modern twist is really coming from your vocals. And you know what? You have a lot of hits on YouTube, more than this stinking podcast is ever going to get. They're destroying us, which is great. And it's wonderful to see great talent coming from the city and going and being successful. You guys are successful in Toronto right now.
We play there.
You play there.
Yes.
You play there.
Yes, we are very successful.
You are successful.
Yes.
More successful than this stinking podcast will ever be. So, but aside from that, I absolutely love your sound. We're not really going to hear so much of it today because we're going to go on a more acoustic side of things. And
it's the way that we write a lot of our music. Where I am the person who writes most of the I write all the music.
Right.
But basically, this is how a lot of the songs start anyway. Okay. So it usually starts with just me and a guitar, and then I hand it off to Ryan and Matthew, and then it goes on from there.
And Ryan, who said he wasn't going to say anything during the podcast, says, I'm going to sit here and play guitar. All of a sudden, he's yammering, and he doesn't have a microphone.
He said so many other words.
I know.
I've said yes a lot.
Yeah.
I've agreed with you, and he's...
He's saying other words that we're not interested in.
Yeah, nobody was.
No, I'm good.
Yep. You good?
All right, well, so the way our format for our podcast works is that we have a couple of guests, and then we like to wrap things up musically, because Peterborough is such a musical place, and this is a Peterborough podcast. It's PTBO Canada. This is how we do it. And we love you guys, so I want to hear some music. What are you going to play for us today?
We're going to play a single off of our new album, which is going to be released January 6th, available to the world January 6th, and we're actually playing January 10th. We're playing at the Gordon Best, a album release show.
Yes.
That'll be fun.
Don't you love the acoustics there?
I do.
Yeah.
Actually, I'm to be honest, I haven't actually played a show there.
Ooh.
I could have been in high school.
Really?
Yeah.
So this is going to be a treat for
you. Yeah, and that was only 5 years ago.
And a treat for me was that I've already heard the new album.
Yes.
Yeah. Ooh, special media rights and privileges, folks. I'm special. All right. What's the name of the track we're going to hear?
Call My Name.
Call My Name. I've heard this.
Sending out a message to the world. I am not an ordinary girl. Sitting tall, acting smart, think wise for sure. Acting up, not a compromise you would. Hey baby, would you call my name? Let me. You made up on Saturday night, making plans and everything's alright. All at once, here come the beautiful girls. All at once, you're not worth their while. Hey, baby, would you call my name? Let me in. Stand your ground. Shout out loud. I'm gonna take your heart and break it in. Pretty sure you don't know what you want. But pretty sure you don't know what you want. So get down on the dance floor, 'cause it's the only good reason to hang out more. I'm pretty sure that I want you to call my name. Take your heart and break it in, then leave you all alone. Guitar! All right, now I'm going to say something and then you're going to say it after me.
Okay.
Whoa, whoa, whoa.
Whoa, whoa, whoa.
Robot Eyes, the new album's coming out January 6th. Thank you so much. PTBO Canada Live Podcast 3 is in the books. See you later. Good night.
Wow.
It's like Newfoundland's another country.
Yeah. So those yeah, it is. Those wieners you're talking about, those are like the high end ones. If you really want to know what we get in our like our lunch pail, is the little Vienna sausages.
Oh
that,
yeah.
That you have to hit like that and take out the top one. That's a real like Newfoundland delicacy. That and bologna, not bologna, bologna.
It's bologna and
yeah,
high-end.
Fry it.
Fried bologna and high-end wieners. That's what we're about on this podcast.
And then like really hard bread.